Well, we're going to continue in our series. I'll encourage you to turn to the letter of Colossians, Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians. We have if you missed last week, don't worry. We have just started. We're jumping right into the middle of the first portion in chapter 1, and it's Paul's prayer for the Colossians. While you're making your way there, I'll just encourage you, Philip, again, we'll be in the gathering place just after the service. You'd love to be able to spend some time and chat with him. And so please do take that opportunity to do that. Well, I trust that you found your way to Colossians. As is our tradition here, in honor of God's word, let us stand again and read. We're going to be reading beginning at verse 9. Colossians chapter 1, beginning at verse 9. This is the word of God. And so, from the day we heard, we have not ceased to pray for you, asking that you may be filled with the knowledge of his will in all spiritual wisdom and understanding, so as to walk in a manner worthy of the Lord, fully pleasing to him, bearing fruit in every good work and increasing in the knowledge of God, being strengthened with all power according to his glorious might, for all endurance and patience with joy, giving thanks to the Father, who has qualified you to share in the inheritance of the saints in light. He has delivered us from the domain of darkness and transferred us to the kingdom of his beloved Son, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. Gracious Father, thank you for your word. We thank you for its power to transform lives today. Father, our prayer this morning is that no corrupting talk would come out of my mouth, but only such as is good for building up and as fits this occasion, that it may give grace to those who hear. Father, forgive every sin that would make me or us an unfit vessel both to speak and to receive this. Thank you for the Savior of sinners who died in our place. Father, soak our hearts in the word of God this morning. Prepare our hearts for listening now and grant us the unction of the Holy Spirit through the word of God to pierce the hearts and minds of those here today. We ask this all in great confidence in Jesus' worthy name. Amen. Please be seated. Well, as we begin this section, Paul continues to tell the Colossians what he's been praying about. He's letting them in on a bit of an insight as to his prayer life, not just about things, but about them, what he thinks of them, and what he believes that they need. Paul and those with him obviously know that if these believers are to be successful in their Christian lives, it won't be because they're smart enough or they're savvy enough, but because they found themselves in need and they found themselves recipients of a great God who loved them. And so from the very onset here, Paul is going to lay this big idea for us as we think about his provision, and that is this, is that God will provide all that is needed for life in Christ. God is going to provide all that is needed for life in Christ. That is to say that God is going to supply every believer's needs. He's going to give us just what we need in order to build us up and make us spiritually mature. Now, I came across a video of a man named Bobby Hastings, and I know that the non-Leaf fans in the room are going to gasp as I show a video. I don't normally show a video for my introductory illustration, but I think it was pretty cool to show you what I found on the internet this week. Like, everything on the internet is good, right? But here is what I found on the internet this morning. I want you to roll that video. I want you to take a look. This is the equipment manager for the Toronto Maple Leafs during a game. You'll notice that he's touching the sticks as he's watching the play happen. What he's doing is he's making sure that if someone's stick breaks at a particular moment, whoever has that puck, he's going to be ready to grab that stick and hand it over the boards, and the person can continue to join in the play. That's Bobby Hastings from the Toronto Maple Leafs. And I know he's not unusual, probably. He's like most of the equipment managers, but he is there to provide exactly in the moment, in the play, what the player needs. As Paul prays, these Colossians are going to learn what will help them stay and succeed, not just in a game of hockey, but but of course in the game of life, which is not a game at all. It's rather a fight against sin and Satan and this desire that he has to rob God of his glory and our passion to give God all of the glory through every bit of our lives. It's also going to be what we need to accomplish all that God intends for us. I look into the faces of people I think that want to live for God. Am I right? You want to glorify God with your life. You want to squeeze the sponge of your life so that every bit of everything that you do is for him. Am I right? Or have I hit the wrong place, right? That's what we're doing, right? Amen. That's what we want to do. Praise God. And so Paul says in verse 9, from the day we heard, that is the day we heard that you have been saved by the grace of God, when I heard of your salvation, we have not ceased to pray for you, asking that you may be filled with the knowledge of his will in all spiritual wisdom and understanding. Right away here in verse 9, we're going to see that God will provide the knowledge of his will. God wants to provide to you and I the knowledge of his will. Here we can see how much Paul really valued prayer. In verse 9, Paul is constantly committed to prayer. And of course, we're thinking, of course, because every believer is constantly committed to prayer. Am I right? Probably not, right? Thank you for the nods of the saints that are actually locked in. But most of us find it a great challenge to pray. We don't often make it this kind of a commitment where we are unceasing in our prayer life. You know, his prayer was not just situational, but it was specific. You know, we often hear something and we go, well, we're going to pray about that now. Paul says, I'm going to pray in advance of these things. God has shown me enough in my life to know that you're going to need certain things in order for you to become a successful believer. And one of those things is that you're going to need the knowledge of his will. So he prays to the Father asking. Some Bible translations begin verse 9 with, for this reason, the ESV has chosen the word so. I don't like it as much because it really doesn't help us to see that it's because of their salvation in verses 3 to 8 that Paul has thanked God and why he's not ceased to pray for them, asking God to equip them for the fight. You see, the fight didn't really start for you at Calvary. The fight begins as a Christian. You know, the Bible says that it promises that every believer will suffer persecution. The Bible doesn't say that unbelievers are promised persecution, but believers are promised the persecution that comes along with knowing Jesus. Why? Because you kind of pick up where Jesus left off. Your life continues, his life continues to be lived through you in the sense of persecution. When God calls people, he wants them to be ready for war. Paul doesn't expect that a loving father would hold back anything that we will need. If God calls you, he will also provide what you and I need. Now, the Greek mindset at the time was that life was pretty predictable. It was very cyclical. There was no ultimate direction, no specific route for you and I. And this led to many people in Greek culture to just say, you know, I'm just going to live for the now. This is just something that everybody has to do. I'm going to pursue whatever pleases me, and then I will die. They don't see themselves on a specific trajectory or part of a weaving of a sovereign that is using us for his glory. When we become Christians, what we learn very quickly is that God has a direction and God has a purpose for every one of us. Each one of us are weaved into the progress of redemption that begins. It's this line that begins through the Bible and continues. Often people talk about Acts 29, what happens after the book of the Acts. We're part of the narrative of God. Christians come along and we are not just in mere existence, but we have a destiny. God has cut us into the rock and he is moving us in the path he has for us. You know, Jesus talked a lot about this. In John 17, 24, he said this. He said, Father, as he prayed, I desire that they also, whom you have given to me, may be with me where I am, to see my glory that you have given me, because you loved me before the foundation of the world. You see how we are integrated into the storyline of the Lord Jesus. Jesus is speaking about a plan. He's speaking about your life and mine, a plan laid by the Father through which people given to him by grace would share in a future with him, God, his glory, and in his presence in a day to come. What exactly has God given us to direct us? Well, you might ask, I guess that's where the question comes, how do we know his will? Because if we can get all excited about being part of a plan of God, we kind of want to know what his will is for us. And of course, the answer is predominantly the word of God. The word of God that is contained in the Bible, the scripture is our guide. Scripture is our rule or ruler, if you are academically inclined. I'm sorry if you were part of the age where you got hit by that ruler in class. I don't think they do that. Do they do that? They don't do that anymore. Not allowed to hit with the ruler. But the rule or the ruler gives us the standard by which God expects us to live. Author Sinclair Ferguson wrote this. Look at the screen. As we come to know the character of God and his ways with men, we shall increasingly discover this wisdom. That is, the practical knowledge of his will and the ways in which it is to be put into action. Sinclair Ferguson wrote a fantastic book on discovering God's will in your life. And there he lists three basic ways that scripture provides a knowledge of God's will. The first way is he gives us direct commandments and prohibitions. And we see this. That's probably the clearest thing that we can see. And as we learn to read God's word progressively, we're able to see, okay, here is what God commands of us as believers today. Now, there are times when we're going to have to make some judgment on what we're reading. If we're reading something in the book of Leviticus, we're going to have to know that there's something about the book of Leviticus, something about the Mosaic law that doesn't apply today for us as believers. But that doesn't mean that we kind of, you know, tear it out. We leave it alone. We don't draw from that because Jesus himself said to disciples on the road to Emmaus, "These things speak of me. They point the people of God today to me." And we can see God directly commanding and prohibiting. But God also gives us principles worked out in Scripture. For example, not everyone is called upon by God to sell all that they have and give all that they have to the poor, which is what Jesus told the rich man in Matthew chapter 19. It is, however, a principle that Jesus must be Lord of all that we have, or he is not Lord at all for you. And so there are principles that the word of God gives us. There are also illustrations that we can look at, ways in which God shows us and teaches us what he is like and what he does and what we should be like, what the expectations are of God's people. We see the mind of God in a variety of different stories in the Bible. So commandments and principles and illustrations. You know, I'm not much of a TV watcher, but I like all the, you know, treasure stuff. You know, if there's like a treasure movie or going on a treasure hunt, I have a little bit of Dora the Explorer in me, and I just love like treasure hunt stuff. Anybody ever watch the Curse of Oak Island? Is that what it's called? Oak Island? Yeah? Okay. That's the most annoying thing in the whole universe to watch because it's like 10 years. It's like this year they're going to find, right, the treasure. They're gonna finally come across. For those who are absolutely no idea what I'm talking about, Oak Island is is off the coast of Nova Scotia in Canada, and it's got world renown fame now because there was apparently some hidden treasure. And again, 10 seasons. I don't know if they already found it in season 2, and they're just holding back on us poor watchers. But they really are looking at, you know, the possibility of treasure that, you know, could be planted there from like famous pirates, and Marie Antoinette is supposed to have her like jewels sent there and buried there, and Blackjack somebody has got his, you know, treasure chest there. It's the thing of legend. You know, when it comes to discovering God's will, most people try to do what they do on the show. I mean, they have tried everything to try to find it. They've gone from like simple metal detectors to heavy machinery, trying with any means possible to find it. And they said a number of times, at the end of this season, season 10, we will not stop. We will try everything until we find it, and then we will stop. And of course, they find a couple of pop cans and, you know, model cars and a couple of coins. But the most amazing thing for them is when they find what they were looking for. And that will be a day hopefully to come. And of course, as a treasure watcher, I would love to be part of watching that. But you know, the most amazing thing here for the Colossians and for us is that God's will is not found like that. It's not found in mysterious ways. We have to kind of go hunting for it. And maybe we might find a pop can, or maybe we might find a nugget of God's will for our lives. We can go to the resource of God's word, and we can truly find the voice of God in his word. We can hear him through his word, the Bible. The Bible warns of the danger of the lack of knowledge. We need to hear God's voice. Hosea chapter 4, verse 6 talks about the problem that Israel had all along, and that my people, Hosea says, are destroyed for lack of knowledge. They don't know God. They profess to know God, but they don't actually know him. Ephesians 4, 13 and 14 tells us of the lack of knowledge and what it produces in the children of God, and in you and I. Paul says they're children. They just stay children, tossed to and fro by the waves and carried about by every wind of doctrine, by human cunning, by craftiness in deceitful schemes. My friends, we learn what it means to have God's mind when circumstances that we face need actions. We can go to God's word and find real answers from a living God who loves us and wants us to find the treasure of himself in his word. You know, the word of God just doesn't make us excited. It changes us as we trust God in his word and our convictions start to line up with the word of God. He starts to change us and make us more like the Lord Jesus. All this is not to say that we deny that we need something supernatural. Obviously, we believe the Bible, and that means we believe that the Holy Spirit is an engaged person involved in us seeing God in his word. And we don't want to deny the spiritual, the supernatural help that God provides to know the will of God. In Ephesians 5, verses 17, 18, Paul takes some time there to say that we need to be filled with the Spirit. I hope that in your study of God's word, you're constantly asking the Spirit of God to show you God's will for your life. And I think that's why here in verse 9, they'll need spiritual wisdom and understanding as well. We need to not only know God's will, but we also need to know when to apply God's will. For example, someone might be faced with a decision between two jobs. Both opportunities are examined. You know, you look at them in terms of their morality. Both provide a suitable wage. They're fair. Both provide time for you and for your family. And you wonder to yourself, what is God's will for my life? What is his will? We're going to need spiritual wisdom and understanding to know what God's specific will is for your life. You're not going to be able to turn to a Bible verse and say, there's my name right there. And he tells me to take job A. One time a person came to me and had this exact scenario, and you know what was different about each one of those? One had a viable church near him that he could go to. The other one did not. So I said, well, which one do you think that the Spirit of God would want to lead you to understand would be the will of God? And so this was very helpful for him as he understood, well, Hebrews, you know, chapter 10, Acts chapter 2, 1 Corinthians 14, all talk about being part of a local church, that is a healthy thing for believers. I guess I know the will of God for my life. Sometimes people say, you know what? I know that's not God's will because I'm going to suffer there, you know? Maybe if I stay in this job, right, it'll mean I'll be persecuted for being a Christian. Well, we're going to need the word of God to help us to know that, wait a second, I think the Bible says somewhere that those who live righteously are going to suffer persecution. I think maybe that might not be an indication, just because someone turned up the heat at work, that maybe I shouldn't be at this particular job. Indeed, all who live godly in Christ will suffer persecution, 2 Timothy 3:12. My friends, that means that God may lead you by his Spirit to stay in a place, in a circumstance that's not exactly nice for you. Without the Spirit of God giving us that spiritual wisdom and understanding, how are we going to make those kind of choices? We're going to fall into our old routines of just going, well, I feel this way, and I feel it's the Word of God. Now listen, I'm not trying to downplay when, you know, we hear people all the time say, God spoke to me. Or I feel like the Lord is leading me to do this or that, or I prayed about that, and I get a sense that God is guiding me in this way. I don't want to downgrade that at all, because oftentimes the Spirit of God leads us through the Word of God so that we feel this is the will of God. But what really bothers me is sometimes it's tingling over texts. It's feelings over facts. When you ask them, so where, what part of God's Word has informed this decision? Say, no, it's just also spiritual. Right? So it's also a work of God in my life. And the Bible is completely vacant from any kind of part of their decision-making. Again, I don't want to downgrade the supernatural, because some people are sub-spiritual, right? There's no working of the Spirit of God. And so they stay where they are, go, unless I get a chapter and a verse, I guess I'm out. I guess I'm going to continue to do this. Rightly and passionately, some want to follow the will of God, but what we can't do is base our obedience on a sense of God's will. We need to be sure, and the Holy Spirit uses God's word to show us the mind of the word of God. You say, well, why is that? My friends, the Holy Spirit will never contradict the word of God. God's Spirit will never contradict the word of God. Why? Because God doesn't lie, right? Numbers 23:19 says just that. And all scripture is breathed out and is profitable for us. 2 Timothy 3:16. Paul says to Timothy, just preach the word and let the Spirit of God guide the people of God. Isn't that the whole trouble that's starting to percolate in Colossae here with these false teachers? Greek philosophy is being mingled with Christianity and Jewish legalism that would later develop into this super, some people have this super knowledge, and some people don't. Here, Paul is saying, I see what's coming. The Spirit of God leading them to trust the Word of God. They need that spiritual wisdom and understanding. If our hope is in Christ, God will provide the knowledge of His will. I have to go on, but First, I have to ask you one question. How do you make decisions? I really want to know. Don't yell it out, but think through that. It's a real question to you, right? How are you making decisions right now? Some of you are making decisions right now. In fact, you say, I'm going to take the weekend to think about that. How are you making those decisions? How does the Word of God play into your understanding of the knowledge of His will? Now, I know what you're thinking, because it's what I'm thinking. There are so many, if not most, of the decisions I make almost completely on my own, without counsel to the Word of God. It just feels right. My friends, as you read God's word and seek to know His will for your life, does your prayer also include asking the Spirit of God to fill you with wisdom and understanding? That's Paul's prayer for these believers. If our hope is in Christ, God will provide all that is needed for life in Him. He'll provide the knowledge of His will. But in verse 10, take a look. God will provide a manner worthy of His Son. God will provide a manner worthy of His Son. The people of God should want to live in the will of God for this reason. Why? So as to walk in a manner worthy of the Lord, fully pleasing to Him. It's not so you could get a better job or a better date or a better car or a better neighborhood or a better situation or a better family. It's so that we can walk in a manner that is worthy of the Lord, fully pleasing to Him. So as, or so that, you would be able to. See that? So often, I think we find people get in situations and they ask themselves, how did I ever get here? Well, obviously, in the sovereignty of God, you got there. But wouldn't it be great to know that every step of the way was layered in asking God for His will for my life so that I can walk in a manner worthy of the Lord? I don't think I've ever had anyone say to me, hey, listen, I need biblical counseling because I want to learn how more to walk worthy of the Lord. Usually, it's situational. I've stepped in something, and now I need to get out. What's also clear here is that having an insight into the will of God is not an end in itself, my friends. Just because a believer knows the will of God does not mean that he or she is pleasing to the Lord. The goal is not how much Bible trivia you can have in your head. Living for the Lord requires that we know him and that we live for him. And so Paul uses this common Jewish idiom of walking, walking. It's not running. You're not making too haste of a decision. You're walking. It's that general pace of life. Much more than a hop, skip, and a jump. You're done. Your walk is a long road that a person, that each believer makes as they make their way along the road of life toward eternity. How true when we realize that it'll take a lifetime for us to learn who God is and to seek to walk like him and to be fully pleasing to him. You see, my friends, there must be a connection between what we know and what we do. It's no use to know the will of God if you have not the desire to live in a manner worthy of the Lord and pleasing to him. I've often wondered about the foggy moments of my life. Do you ever get those foggy moments? You're like, I don't know what's going on right now, right? And I look at this and I looked back at my life and I thought, I wonder if all I wanted was the will of God, but I wasn't exactly really ready for whatever his answer was. I was really prepared to do whatever I wanted to do, and really what I wanted is I wanted his support for my idea. I really didn't have the mind to walk in a manner worthy of the Lord. You see how they go together? What a reminder that we can be Christians on paper, committed to God intellectually, but a life void of evidence of it. We can live disobedient lives with no resemblance of the Lord Jesus and carry the biggest Bible in the room. Is that not what Jesus called out among the religious leaders of the day? When he told them, you smell like a rotting corpse, is what Jesus told those religious leaders who thought they were all of that and more. What we learn here is that the believer is most like Jesus when they don't just think like him, but they also seek to live like him. How true of Jesus. The life that was public was consistent with the life that people did not see in him. And Paul knows this, and he sees this, and this was his own desire, and he prays the same for these churches like Corinth, and he would pray the same thing for us. He said of himself in Philippians, "For me to live is Christ. All I want is Christ." In that portion of Philippians, it's no surprise that right after that, when he says, "For me to live is Christ, all I want is Christ," he then says something similar. He says, "So let your manner of life be worthy of the gospel." Striving together. Amen. Friends, this has to be what we are all about. We need to renounce ungodliness and worldly passions, and we need to live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives in this present age. You remember the Sesame Street skit, "One of these things is not like the other"? Remember they put three shoes and a boot, and they teach kids, well, you know, this is the difference. I often wonder, when God looks at us, if he sees some of us on track and some of us not, would you be that person that would be the boot in that analogy? One of these things is not like the other. Your desire for the understanding of God's will does not align with your desire to live in a manner worthy of the gospel. Verse 10 says that we must be fully pleasing to him. That was Paul's prayer. In every type or sort of pleasing, is the literal there, fully pleasing. Is this your life? Listen to the prayer of the Hebrew writer in chapter 13, verse 20 and 21. "Now may the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, equip you with everything good that you may do his will, working in us that which is pleasing in his sight through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen." God's own grace and power is at work in us to be like Jesus. Oh, you thought you were on your own to do that. My friends, God is at work in us. He wants to do this in us. Will you let him? Paul prays that you will. God's desire is that you will. And so if our hope is in Christ, God will provide all that is needed for life in him. He'll provide the knowledge of his will, and he'll provide again for us this re-understanding, this illumination that we have, this wonderful example in Jesus, so that we can live in a manner worthy of his son. But as we make our way to the end of this passage, we have this big section from verses 10 to 14, and this is what we're going to see, is that God will provide a process for his people, a process for his people. Of course, not every new believer knows exactly, well, okay, yeah, I'm with you, but how do I please the Lord? We've got to learn what it means to please the Lord. Do you know how to please the Lord? Now, for sure, all of those who love God, who have a genuine faith in Christ, have a desire to live for him, to please God. The writer of the Hebrews in the New Testament tells us that faith is essential, that without faith, you cannot please him. So who's going to please God in the world? The believer, the one who has faith, right? We are the ones that please the Lord. It's always so encouraging, you know, to meet a brand new believer. Their world has been completely turned upside down. Most of it's a train wreck socially, but they just love the Lord Jesus, and they're the first one there. They're there before you open the door. Why? They're so excited to be part of the family of God, and all they want to do is to please the Lord, and they're asking you, how do I please the Lord? How do I do this? And so Paul tells them here, listen, this is how you make it your aim to please him. In verse 10, Paul gives us four things that please God. There are ways or aspects that I think should challenge all of us, but here are the four things that he says to these new believers. The first is in verse 10. He says, God's people do good. He says that they bear fruit in every good work. He wants us to be bearing fruit in every good work. Believing in Jesus, you see, is an active lifestyle. I don't know if you thought about it that way, but it's an ongoing lifestyle. It's a lifestyle that lives. It shows out the faith that we have in him. We invite the Holy Spirit to work in and through all of our circumstances and all of our relationships. God works in what we do. That's how God has made us in Christ. I remember there's a guy I knew in Alberta, and he was all about John Deere equipment. You know, the guys who have, like, all their clothes are all that special green, right? you just know, you see them coming. They're all about John Deere. And they, you know, they repeat the commercials that, you know, and that they just integrate the commercials into their, and you know, this one guy always said, you know, nothing runs like a deer. It didn't matter what the conversation was about. He just always say, well, it's not a deer, right? Nothing runs like a deer. And I looked into that. I was thinking about it this week, and it was a slogan that kind of began in the 70s, and it was actually related to snowmobiles only, right? Only the snowmobiles had this slogan. Nothing runs like a deer. But then when they stopped making snowmobiles in 1982, another department grabbed that. I think it was like lawn equipment. And then it eventually became like the pervasive everything. Nothing runs like a deer. It was a slogan of their commitment of what they wanted to be. You know, when God is involved in life, nothing runs like a Christian. Nothing shows the love of God like a believer. You know, we need to exemplify all that it means to be all that God has made us to be. And yet, I guess my problem and where my flinching is, I don't know if that's true in my life always. I don't always think that I am doing good works in light of the glory of God. Do the things that you do, everything that you do, is it all done for the glory of God? Am I the only one that feels like so much of my life is done for myself or something else? Paul says, Lord, I pray that they would bear fruit in every good work. Lord, produce in them what they can't do in their own lives by themselves. More than this, we find that we should always be bearing fruit. Always be bearing fruit. You know, Jesus says in John 15, as he describes the Father as the vine dresser and him as the vine, he says, listen, there will be branches that need to be pruned. Sometimes we go through life and those good works that we do don't always get a lot of the good feelings that we think they should have. And so oftentimes people get discouraged. My friends, if we're living in accordance with the will of God, and we're seeking to live in a manner worthy of him, and we are bearing good works, that's not always going to feel great. Sometimes we're going to be persecuted. Sometimes we're going to be unnoticed. But my friends, God does not miss a heartbeat. God sees all that you and I do. And God wants to see a living faith. We don't have time to go there, but James 2 talks about that, where James says, hey, what good is it if someone says he has faith but does not have works? Can that faith save him? Faith by itself, James says, if it does not have works, is dead. That doesn't mean that that good works get you to heaven, but the life of faith is a life of good works. Are you bearing good works? If we're pursuing the ways of God's people, we're going to do good. Next, in verse 10, God's people go deep. They go deep. They increase in the knowledge of God. The Bible is uniform in its desire for God's people to have a relationship with him. Now, again, I don't have time to go into this, but let me tell you this, is that God is not so much interested, again, in what you know. He's interested in a relationship with you. All through the Bible, you can check this all you want. When you go from Genesis to Revelation, every time you come across the word know, to know God, it's not just information. It's not just that God knows something about you when he says he knew them. It's about relationship. If you look in the book of Genesis, Adam knew his wife. If you read the King James, knew his wife. What is he talking about? He's having marital relationships. He's having a marital relationship moment with Eve, right? To know somebody is to have a relationship. It's not just intellectual. It's terms of endearment. We need to look at this. I mean, just take a few moments. I mean, Philippians 3, Paul says this. He says, but whatever gain I had, as he's talking about his former life, he says, I counted that as loss for the sake of Christ. Indeed, I count everything as loss for the sake, because of the surpassing worth of, wait for it, for the surpassing worth of knowing Christ, Jesus, my Lord. Paul doesn't want these believers just to be these, you know, big fat heads with these skinny bodies. Oh, I know a lot about the Bible. He wants them to know Jesus intimately. My friends, is that true of you? Do you go deep in your relationship with him, or are you just surface level? Not only do they go deep, but in verse 11, God's people grow strong. Because as they live for him and they seek to know his will and they walk in a manner, they are being strengthened with all power according to his glorious might. You know, I'm starting to watch Star Trek again, the new Strange New Worlds. Any Trekkies in the room? Like zero, right? Maybe one Trekkie, couple Trekkies, right? I kind of miss the old days when all the problems were all solved, when Kirk would get on the radio and go, Scotty, we need more power, right? And for some strange reason, there would be a bop and a boop and a turn and a push of something down there, and Scotty would bring the power, and there would be all the problems that would be solved. Maybe there are those of us seeking to explore a strange new world of living for God. I know that was to be true of the Colossians. And we begin to wonder why it takes so long for God to provide the strength that we need. Why don't we just call down to Scotty and ask Scotty to do something, right? Paul seems to know where the power is found in verse 11, doesn't he? Did you notice how passive we are in this process? Paul says that we are being strengthened. Being strengthened. This is not something that you and I can do on our own. This is something that has been done for us and is being done for us absolutely every day. If you haven't been paying attention, pay attention now. Listen to this. The strength that you and I need to be successful as Christians, what we need to get to the end of our journey, the end of our walking, is not because we own the strength in ourselves. It'll be because it is according to his glorious might. We have a God who is one who is power-packed and ready to give you all that you need to be successful. Listen to the psalmist in Psalm 28, verse 7. The Lord is my strength. Not that he has the strength. The Lord himself is my strength and my shield. In him my heart trusts, and I am helped. The Lord himself is my strength. He tells us here, Paul does, and back in Colossians, that he's going to provide the endurance. He's going to help us get to where we need to go. He's going to provide the patience that comes along with that. And lo and behold, look at this three-letter word at the end. In verse 11, he's going to be giving us joy. Ever met a Christian with real joy? Real joy? Say, what do you have to be happy about? Your life is an absolute ruin. Look how much people hate you. I'm in the will of God. I'm doing exactly what God wants me to do. I'm being faithful. I'm walking in a manner that is worthy of the Lord. I know that I'm fully pleasing to him. My friends, we need to do good. We need to go deep. We need to grow strong. And finally, Paul closes out by just this great exclamation of thanksgiving in verses 12 to 14. God's people give thanks. In verse 12, Paul says that his prayer is that they would be a thankful people, giving thanks to the Father who has qualified you to share in the inheritance of the saints in light. So much can be said here. He has delivered you. He has qualified you. You know, I was thinking about this whole thing about qualification. If you are unqualified, well, everybody will give you a bit of a break. All you need to do is become qualified. But my friends, we were much more than unqualified when God found us and qualified us for him, for his kingdom. We were disqualified. We were in sin and far from God, unable of our own self to get into heaven, to be made perfect, which is, by the way, God's standard for holiness is perfection. But we have been made holy. We have been made saints in our text. Verse 14, in whom? In the beloved Son, we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. Redemption means to be rescued by payment of a ransom. And it is used in the context of freeing slaves. What is that ransom? What is it that's going to free us? It's the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. My friends, today, if you do not know the Lord Jesus Christ, if you have never received him as your Savior, you have never allowed him to be the center of your life, if you're living for yourself, you're not redeemed, you are not forgiven, my friends, there has blood been shed for sinners just like you. We pray that by God's grace, you would receive him as your Lord and Savior, because the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God, the free gift of God in Jesus Christ, our Lord. In him, we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our sins. I want to show you more of that video as we close. Take a look, because as we see the equipment manager touching the sticks, watching the play, looking to see what player is going to need what at what moment, we'll see something incredible happen. Because this is actually footage from another game, but I'll show you what happens when the equipment manager comes through for his players. Now, this is the Leafs in the corner. You watch, you might not pick it up, but the guy breaks his stick right at the top of the screen, grabs a stick off the bench, scores. And you don't see it. Well, I did a close-up for you. This is the play again. Look at the guy, breaks his stick, goes to the bench, grabs a stick, gets into the play, scores. Now, we'll slow this down. Here he is. He's like, I think my stick might be broken. I don't know. Maybe I need a new stick. I know. Call the stick, drop the stick, running, skating, got the stick. There he goes. Now watch what happens. Scores the goal. And what does he do? He points. What is he pointing at? The equipment manager, who is ready to provide just what is needed in the moment. My friends, the Christian life is no game. And, you know, there will be times when the equipment manager fails. I'm sure that will definitely be the case. But my friends, we have a God who loves us and has given everything for us. He will be ready to provide all that is needed for our life in Christ. God will provide the knowledge of his will, a manner worthy of his Son, and a process for his people. And so we need to go deep, do good, grow strong, and give thanks. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your grace in all of what we have heard this morning. We pray, Father, that as we learn with these Colossians what it means to be a believer, maybe we've been in Christ for a long time by your grace, but we have maybe stalled in our relationship with you, and we need to be reminded what is fully pleasing to you. Father, help us as we seek to do so. For we ask it in Jesus' worthy and precious name. Amen.